Well, I heard you had good to rockin' tonight. Well, I heard you knew that's a good to rockin' tonight. I'm gonna hold my baby till as tight as I can. Tonight she'll know I'm a mighty, mighty man. I heard you knew that's good to rockin' tonight. I say, oh, meet me in a hurry behind the bar. Don't you be afraid, I'll do you no harm. I want you to bring along my rocking shoes, cause tonight I'm going to rock away all the blues. I heard in you, there's good to rockin' tonight.
My name is Todd Slaughter, and I have the honour of being the secretary of the world's most respected Elvis Presley fan club, the official Elvis Presley fan club of Great Britain and the Commonwealth. As you may know, every year the fan club's own travel service operates a trip to America, which gives the opportunity to a fortunate few to realise the ambition of every Elvis fan, the opportunity of seeing Elvis's Memphis. This year, we've decided to make a videotape of our trip, which we believe gives a very accurate view of the atmosphere in Memphis, and will serve as a permanent record to all those who have travelled with us in the past, and also as a souvenir for those fans who probably will never be able to afford to visit America. So let us leave the sweltering 55 degrees of a British summer and travel with us some 4,000 miles to the 95 degrees of a much warmer place, Elvis's Memphis.
The first thing that strikes any visitor from Northern Europe on their first visit to Memphis is the heat. Occasionally in Britain we swelter in 80 degrees of the stuff, but in Memphis when it's over 100 and the humidity is high, then you just dissolve. Elvis fans from all over the world dissolve in Memphis every August. The locals are used to the heat, but the visitors consume gallons of Coca-Cola in an effort to replace a tidal flow of perspiration that hits each alien every time he or she dares to step outside of an artificially cool environment. Hotels, schools, homes, shops, cars and coaches are all air-conditioned, so there's a shock to the system on your first day in Elvisland. Since 1972, the official Elvis Presley fan club of Great Britain has taken a total of 4,500 of its members to the United States. Initially, these visits were to see Elvis in concert, either in Las Vegas or on tour. It's interesting to note, however, that a good two-thirds of that figure of 4,500, over 3,000 people in fact, have travelled to Memphis with the club since Elvis died in 1977.
We'll be right back. Could not leave a number, but I know who placed the call. Marco took the message and he wrote it on the wall. Help me, information, to get in touch with my Marie. She's the only one who could phone me here from Memphis, Tennessee. Her home is on the south side, high up on a ridge, just a half a mile from the Mississippi Bridge.
Familiar visitors of Memphis travelling with the fan club will receive their first welcome from a Trailways coach driver. Some of our drivers have been with us from the start, and many of them joke that they're growing old with the Elvis Presley fan club. It's no exaggeration to state that every year we announce our itinerary, the same handful of Trailways chauffeurs jostle for their position in the annual fan club roster. To retrace Elvis Presley's roots, all Elvis Presley fans must first visit Elvis's first contact with the city, Humes High School. Elvis was 13 years old when his parents brought him to Memphis in 1948, and Humes High was an all-white establishment. Now, because of its location in downtown Memphis, the majority of its pupils are ironically black. But they are still very proud of their former old boy. Even when Elvis joined the school, it was old and enormous in comparison to what the Tupelo boy had been used to, 1,700 pupils making up its six classes. Elvis was an outsider from the start. His hillbilly ways brought him few friends, and his overprotective mother, escorting him to school even at the age of 15, brought Elvis considerable embarrassment. When he finally broke free of her apron strings, she didn't exactly let go of her only son. Still overprotective of his safety, she would follow him to school at a respectable distance of 200 yards behind him. It was Elvis's guitar picking after classes on the school steps that would win Elvis his friends, or should we say companions, who stayed with him for the rest of his life.
If you look to my right tree, over there, Elvis sat under that tree and played his guitar. If you follow me a little bit, this is a cornerstone with all the numbers of
1920. In previous years, visitors to the city were only permitted to photograph the exterior of the building. Today, the PTA and the Board of Governors allow the party faithful to tread the same boards, sit at the same seats and lean on the same desks where Elvis and his classmates spent their formative years. Elvis graduated with a class of 53 in 1953, an educational system quite foreign to Europeans, but one which obviously satisfied Elvis and his parents. Elvis would give an impromptu concert at any time for his newfound friends, but an open-air performance to a large public audience gave Elvis Presley one of his biggest ever shots of adrenaline.
This is the stage where Elvis went on to first perform, and he was a warm-up act for Slim Whitman, and it was here that the first show he performed was not well accepted at all. He did mostly his country music numbers since it was a country show. And the second show, though, he did his faster rock and roll numbers that he was so well noted for. And the fans began to stand up and scream and holler and shout, and he was a smashing success. And it was after that that the rest is pretty well history.
But it was inside a lowly converted garage that the die was finally cast.
This is where Elvis first came to record, and he worked at a place called Crown Electric at the time, and he worked driving an old Ford pickup truck delivering construction material to different construction sites throughout the city, and very often passed this way en route. And it was here that he noticed a sign hanging in the window that said, you could record a record for $4.
When RCA paid Sam Phillips $35,000 for Elvis's contract in 1955, Phillips pushed most of his money into a business project that was only just getting off the ground. Skeptics thought it an unwise investment, but his windfall brought Sam Phillips a considerable shareholding in the Holiday Inn Corporation.
She done told me, Papa done told me too, son, that guy you fooling with, she ain't no good to you, but that's all right.
On the 14th of August 1980, the Memphis City Parks Department honored their super citizen with the unveiling of a memorial statue sculptured by Eric Parks. Fittingly, the statue and surrounding plaza are located in Beale Street, opposite Lasky's Clothing Store, Elvis's favorite haunt for loud clothes in a street noted for its loud music and ever so loud ladies.
Leaving town, baby, I'm leaving town for sure. Well, then you won't be bothered with me hanging round your door. But that's all right, that's all right, that's all right now, mama, anyway do. Ah, da da dee 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 dee. I need your loving. That's all right. That's all right, mama. Anyway, do.
There is only one time in Memphis over the annual anniversary of Elvis's death that fans from all parts of the world congregate in silent vigil to commemorate the passing of a very special entertainer. At midnight, a candlelight ceremony is dispensed to an emotional gathering who flock here each year to share their feelings with fellow fans. After the benediction, the Graceland gates are opened and the thronging thousands become a single column of people in candlelight procession to the gravesides of Elvis and his family. Elvis is flanked by his grandmother and his father. His mother is also laid to rest in the meditation gardens, and there is a marker in memory of Jesse Garron, Elvis's stillborn twin brother.
All the way, every hour, every day, from
going to open the street back up. in just a few minutes. So please watch for the cars. The streets are going to open back up in just a few minutes. Please watch for the cars.
A gentle announcement from a police department who every year closed down Elvis Presley Boulevard, that six-lane highway equivalent to Britain's M1 motorway, so that the believers may congregate. The lights of the shopping plaza across the road from Graceland take on an appearance of a mini Las Vegas. The area has, since Elvis's death, been the subject of constant criticism by those that would prefer the money changers to be thrown out of the temple, save for Jimmy Velvet's museum. Today, these shops and stores are the property of the Elvis estate. Jimmy Velvet's Elvis Presley Museum is the culmination of one man's attempt to privately and very successfully display some of the singer's treasured artifacts. The museum houses the greatest collection of Presley memorabilia seen outside of Graceland. All of the fans who view this collection view it with awe, but some of the more discerning fans realise that the original providers of the relics may not be real friends to the Elvis Society. Elvis's personal this, Elvis's personal that, loaned to the museum by so-and-so. It makes you wonder how so-and-so obtained it in the first place. At least the fans are thankful that with integrity, Jimmy Velvet records all for everyone to see.
Take me to the fair, take me to the fair, don't know anywhere I would rather be. Let's go to the fair, we'll walk hand in hand through Tomorrowland, honey, you and me.
In Britain we have Alton Towers, Denmark has its Legoland, Florida, California and even Tokyo each have a Disneyland, so why shouldn't Memphis have Liberty Land? Liberty Land is a typical American theme park with all those crazy rides to make you think your stomach is several feet behind you. In his youth, Elvis loved Liberty Land. Unable to ride the roller coaster during public hours, Elvis would rent the property after dark, exclusively for himself and a few chosen aides. When Lisa was old enough to ride the major attractions, Elvis again would rent the park. The age of the train may have bypassed Memphis, but no fun fair is complete without a train. And why not? It was one of Lisa's favourite rides. Even some of the fans that visit Memphis themselves become permanent memorials to Elvis, like this young lady who is wearing a t-shirt of tickets, tickets for concerts Elvis sadly never performed. There's no mistaking that in August, Liberty Land and Memphis are taken over by Elvis devotees, much to the bewilderment of the population at large. Hey look, that's a hot dog on a stick, and there's corn on the cob. You don't see many ice lollies in the States, but you do see an awful lot of snow cones. They're made of crushed ice covered in syrup. Anything fattening seems to go down very well in the USA. There are no tigers, lions or elephants here, just things you can pat and stroke and hold, and make believe that you can own, if just for a minute or so. I wonder if the animals actually like it. Now here's the ride that most people avoid, but one that the brave have to queue for up to an hour to enjoy. There's a corkscrew in every city of the state, but I bet Memphis has one of the best.
Thank you.
And of course, it doesn't matter if you get wet when it's 100 degrees outside. The amazing thing is you dry off very quickly, only immediately to perspire once you are dry again. So oddly enough, the only way to get dry a second time is to get wet a second time, and many do. For many travellers to the States on the Elvis Presley Fan Club's annual visit, it will be their one and only opportunity to visit the other side of the world. Ever conscious of this responsibility, the organisers and the hoteliers take care of every detail, including a champagne reception and a party to follow that will find almost everyone in the pool. It doesn't matter though, because even in the still of night, the temperature may still be well into the 80s. Who's for a moonlight swim? One of the main focal points of any USA holiday is the pool. An energetic dip first thing in the morning is needed to start your senses, especially after the night before. Others find the pool a useful tool after sightseeing and shopping, and many find it wonderful relief during a hard day's sunbathing. One of the many guests who popped in to say hello was drummer DJ Fontana, who worked with Elvis Presley right from the start. Terry Maley takes up the story.
I'm really thrilled to be here.
Right, a lot of the people probably don't know when you first started recording with Elvis. Could you tell us just a little bit about
Well, there were some Sun things earlier, and I didn't do some of the first stuff. Like Heartbreak Hotel was the big one. I mean, that
yeah,
on
the
Victor.
RCA days, yeah. On
they, they used to come in town, Scotty, Bill, and Elvis. And do some stuff, and I didn't live in Memphis.
Mm-hmm.
So they would come in town and do whatever they had to do. But I lived in Shreveport, Louisiana,
yeah.
So I wasn't here all the time.
Mm-hmm.
I never did live in Memphis, so I was kind of commuting back and forth.
And then after the first record, you were?
Well, after that, I did them all.
Basically regular, yeah.
Yeah, I done Hound Dog, Don't Be Cruel, mm-hmm. Jailhouse Rock. Yeah.
And we know through tapes that have come to light that it's taken sort of 32 takes, etc., to get a song the way I always wanted it. What did that sort of do to you, you know, doing the background music?
Well, nothing really. You just go in and, you know, you just do a day's work.
Mm-hmm.
And if things wasn't just right, sometimes he would cancel a whole session. He'd
mm-hmm.
say, it's not really happening, fellas. Let's go home and we'll come back tomorrow.
That's it.
And because he wanted it right, and we wanted it right, but if it wasn't somehow what the Americans call gelling, putting it together,
yeah.
Well, he would cancel the session and say, we'll come back tomorrow and try again.
Of course, after the first few shows, it sort of took off from there and he went on the road.
Yeah, we stayed on the road for a long, long time.
And what was this, just going about in an ordinary car?
Yeah, it started out basically, Scotty Moore had the only car
mm-hmm.
of the bunch. And we started out in his car, and as Elvis made a few bucks, he would buy a car as we went along, you know. And the next thing you know, he just started buying Cadillacs, so we just started driving around in Cadillac limousines.
And we always traveled together. Elvis never went on ahead, and you caught him up or anything?
Very, sometimes, if he had other things to do before we got into town, he would either, well, there for a while, he wouldn't even fly. So, but then, there for a long time, he started to fly a little bit. So he would fly into the next town to meet us there. So we'd just drive on to the next city and pick him up. I had never done any TV at all. And we went to New York to do the Dorsey Brothers, which was a playoff of the Jackie Gleason, you know, shows. And we did six shows with them. But they'd always like book us going in to New York. And as soon as we get through with the show, we'd go to Richmond, Virginia, Norfolk. They would book us coming back.
That's it.
So we didn't waste any time, you know. The first movie was a lot of fun that I
did. Loving You.
Loving You. And after that, it got pretty old.
I do remember when we saw G.I. Blues and came up with sort of sawn-off shorts.
The Alpine uniforms.
That's it, yes.
That's what the Alpines, you know, with the dogs
and stuff. I just
wondered,
you know, what you felt of doing that type of thing.
Well, I thought the guy was kidding. I went down to the wardrobe and the guy says, "Here, DJ, here's your clothes." And he had his short pants and his little knickers and everything. And I said, "Come on." I said, "They were always pulling jokes on you anyhow." I said, "Give me my clothes and let me go. I've got to go back to, you know, the set." He said, "This is it." I said, "Come on, quit the fooling around." I said, "You know, I ain't got much time here. I've got to go back." He said, "That's it." And he was serious. So I went and put him on. And some next thing you know, I'm sitting on the set. And here comes a little makeup girl. I said, "Now, what do you want?" She said, "Well, I got to make up your knees. Put makeup on." I said, "For what?" I said, "I'm going to be sitting behind the drums. You'll never see my knees." She said, "Got to do it." So she powdered my knees real well. Yeah, we did all the movie stuff. Good or bad, we did it. And
what was your last actual recording session with Elvis? Was that the 68?
I done the 68 special, the original Singer sewing machine, you remember? And that was the greatest thing that ever happened. He looked so good. I've watched that film. He just looked fantastic. He really did. And he felt good. He was a little nervous. In fact, he was a lot nervous about the whole show. So I stayed out with him an extra couple of days. He said, "Why don't you stay around?" You know, after we got through, Scotty and I got through, he said, Scotty had come back to Nashville. He said, "You mind staying around?" I said, "I'll stay around a couple of days, you know."
That's it.
So, yeah, he always wanted someone to be around him that he knew real well. And
the latest thing we've had in England has been out here a little while. This is this I Was The One LP, where you overdub on it.
Everyone overdubbed.
How did that come about?
But what they did, they gave me just a cassette tape. So I had to go home and learn all those licks over again. After 20, 25 years, you can't remember them, you know.
Because we in England think, you know, you shouldn't tamper with, you know, classic music if you
well,
feel like, you know.
You know, it's a funny thing. I explained that to those producers. I said, "I don't think the foreign markets are going to like this thing, boys." I said, "You're tamping with the original conception of the music." I said, "They're not going to like it." And their theory was, we've got to beef it up, enhance it, for stereo sound.
Anyway, thanks again for sparing us the half an hour, 20 minutes, or whatever.
Enjoyed it.
And now, here's something that will have you walking on air, whether you're a crew cut or a long hair.
Which kind of music do you like? Classical? Pops? You name it, RCA Victor's got it. The music you want, when you want it, by the world's greatest artists. Exciting new releases include Scheherazade with Morton Gould in his orchestra, Two Grand, Keyboard Fantasy featuring Arthur Whittemore and Jack Lowe, Calypso, a memorable collection of West Indian music by Harry Belafonte, Sax in Satin, a bold adventure in style and sound by Bobby Dukoff, his orchestra and chorus, and Elvis Presley, new RCA Victor star, belts out a bevy of rhythm hits. Hear them at your RCA Victor dealers now.
Now, just wait a minute, please. please. Now, I know that Elvis is going to be here, and you'll want his autographs and everything, and he's a very nice guy, and I'm very glad to, but I don't want any of this rough stuff. You understand?
Hey, man, do you really know Elvis Presley?
Are you kidding? Do I know Elvis Presley? I remember when he was a kid, and he used to sing on a farm.
Was he good then?
Are you kidding? He used to make the pig squeal. I know that. You just stand here. You get him. You understand? You'll get the whole thing. Everybody, I'll stand in line, and I want... Hey, what are the Rich Brothers doing here? What are they doing? I was... Hey, young man, if you want an autograph, would you stand in the back there?
Well,
I don't care who you are. Everybody wants...
I'm Elvis Presley.
You're Elvis. You're kidding. I know Elvis Presley better than I know the A&P Gypsies. Are you kidding?
You do?
I know Elvis Presley, 6 feet tall. He's big shoulders. He's got lovely hair, and he's got blue eyes, and... Elvis Presley. Give me the good old Rudy Valley days. Elvis, sing your hit song. Take it away. Tell you something, incidentally, ladies and gentlemen, I don't think that I'm revealing any secrets when I say that that Elvis Presley is the fastest rising young singer in the entertainment industry today. And as a proof of this, Elvis, I would like to present this to you. It's a special, well, it's a great award from one of the great theatrical periodicals of all times, the Billboard, and back east and all over the country. They present you this. I'd like to read it for you. Years with these lights. This Triple Crown Award presented to Elvis Presley for his RCA Victor recording of Heartbreak Hotel. There it is, ladies and gentlemen. Let's hear it.
Every city has a seedy side, an area that probably isn't too safe to walk around unless you know the district. But in a group, and particularly an escorted group, you're okay. In downtown Memphis, you find the American Sound Studios, where in January and February of 1969, Elvis Presley, during two sessions, recorded some of his most explosive material.
The 36 songs were recorded in 12 days, The Suspicious Minds, Kentucky Rain, Don't Cry Daddy, In the Ghetto, Mama Like the Roses.
Yes. Good stuff. Were you actually here when they did it?
No, I was not here when Elvis was in the building. That was Chip's moment. He was the owner of this area over here is exactly where Elvis stood when he sung the 36 songs in 12 days here. The piano is at the same location, the drum booth, the bass booth in the back, the organ was here, and the guitar was on the left of Elvis. The musicians on this session with Bobby Wood on the piano, Gene Crispin on the drums, Mike Leach and Tommy Cogville would alternate in the back booth playing bass. Bobby Emmons was on the organ and Reggie Young on guitar. I moved into the building 2 days before Elvis passed away to use as a working recording studio, and we tried to preserve Elvis's memory here after his death on August the 16th. So we do still have a working recording studio at the present.
Long Black Limousine, Don't Cry Daddy, Inherit the Wind, In the Ghetto, Suspicious Minds. Why oh why did Elvis never return to ASS? There are a few times in Elvis's career when he was able to work with real craftsmen. At American Sound, he was with some of the finest. According to his late producer, Felton Jarvis, this new studio with new musicians probably proved a greater challenge than at any other time in his career. The choice to visit American Sound was Elvis's, the studio being famous at the time due to a string of successful recordings by people like the Box Tops and Britain's Dusty Springfield.
A chauffeur at the wheel crashed up so fast.
Visit Memphis, Elvis history is lying just around every other corner. But it's not always easy to find. A newly discovered gem for a few of our group was the store Selecto Hits. Come with me and take a look inside this place. It's 108 degrees outside, it's as humid as hell, but inside, even with the television lights on, it's relatively cool, albeit a bit iffy. There's a lot of sun gold in here.
Memphis is a place for record collectors, and we've found the place that in the 60s, Elvis fans could come to. Go through this warehouse and actually find many, many of Elvis's early Sun singles. The place is still here today and you can still find Sun singles, but alas, not by Elvis. These are Carl Perkins and Jerry Lee. I guess in Britain they're worth £4 or £5 each, but you can pick them up here for about 50 cents.
Although in real terms, Nashville and Memphis are only 200 miles apart, and of course, both are in the state of Tennessee, in the real world, they are worlds apart. So a visit to Nashville is of prime importance, particularly as Elvis Presley spent much of his time recording in that city. Nashville, of course, is famous for country music and hillbilly attitudes. There's a cowboy-booted, Stetson-hatted guitar picker on every street corner. And whilst all the ladies are not of part and proportions, some of them come pretty near it. When you visit Nashville, you hear of singers such as Minnie Pearl and Ernest Tubb, names totally foreign to the majority. But when you arrive here, you'll certainly know you're in Nashville. First port of call has to be the Grand Ole Opry, now known as the Ryman Auditorium. Opry, of course, is a derivation of the word opera house and was the premier venue for all of America's country stars. The Opry House is now closed, but live broadcasts of the Grand Ole Opry program come from Opryland, courtesy of WSM Nashville. And Nashville, of course, now has a nationwide cable television service based on country music and known as the Nashville Network.
Why must I love a heartless one who'll never know the harm she's done? Though love is blind, I should have known. Just call me lonesome from now on. I climb the stairs up to my room.
Hollywood Boulevard, where the stars come out in the paving stones, is recreated inside the Country Music Hall of Fame. But here, of course, the stars are not stars of motion pictures, but are stars of country music. And just as there's a star for Elvis in Hollywood Boulevard, there's a star for Elvis in the Country Music Hall of Fame.
These walls will hide me when I cry.
Although Elvis never toured outside of North America, Elvis's gold Cadillac did make one or two overseas appearances. It was a hit in Japan, and mile-long queues formed outside of an Australian department store full of fans anxious to catch a glimpse of one of Elvis's possessions. Of course, like his gold suit, the gold Cadillac isn't really made of gold. The gold paint is yellowing somewhat, though most of the fittings were in fact originally dipped or gold-plated. The car itself was given to the Country Music Hall of Fame by Elvis and the Colonel, and has been horizontally chopped in half so that when the lid lifts off, you can see the hidden extras. Obviously today, such extras are not as unusual as they would have been in the 50s, when Elvis first owned the vehicle. Out of all the exhibits in the museum, it is certainly the one that attracts the most attention, but of course, it's also the one that occupies the most space. It's also possible to miss it. One group on our tour some years ago had to return to Nashville just to look at the Cadillac. A Nashville visit means a tour of the homes of the stars of country music, and you get the opportunity to peer through the gates and the trees of the homes of people, most of which you will never have heard of, but at least you are told you are looking at the dwellings of important people. Country personage Webb Pierce has this unusual swimming pool. Most of the people who admire it have never heard of Webb Pierce, but who has? I suppose for Webb Pierce's sake, it's just as well he never played a penny whistle. Although in Nashville there is a recording studio on every street corner, very few people get the opportunity to see inside one. Housed in a building owned by Chet Atkins, this RCA studio is where Elvis Presley worked.
Well, I quit my job down at the car wash. I left my mama a goodbye note. By sundown, I left Kingston with my guitar under my coat. I hitchhiked all the way down to Memphis, got a room at the YMCA. For the next 3 weeks, I went a-hunting them nightclubs looking for a place to play. Well, I thought my picking would set them on fire, but nobody wanted to hire a guitar man.
The control panel here is much the same as it was when Elvis Presley last recorded there in June of 1971.
Georgia on an overloaded poultry truck. I thumbed on down to Panama City, started picking out some of them all-night bars. I hoping I could make myself a dollar making music on my guitar. I got the same old story, them all-night peers. There ain't no room around here for a guitar man. We don't need a guitar man, son. So I slept in the hobo jungles. I roamed 1,000 miles of track. Till I found myself in Mobile, Alabama. Had a club they called Big Jack's. A little four-piece band was jamming. So I took my guitar and I set in. I showed them what a band would sound like. I was a swinging little guitar man. Show them, son.
Believe it or not, you can drive from Nashville all the way to Tupelo along the Natchez Trace, a parkway which was originally a Red Indian migration pathway. Most people, however, prefer to take the highway through Memphis and over the state border into Mississippi, home of Southern hospitality.
If you ever take a trip down to the ocean, find yourself down around Mobile. Make it on out to a club called Jack's if you got a little time to kill. Just follow that crowd of people, you'll wind up out on his dance floor. Digging the finest little five-piece group up and down the Gulf of Mexico. Guess who's leading that five-piece band? Wouldn't you know, it's that swinging little guitar man. Yeah, yeah.
Tupelo, of course, is Elvis Presley's birth town, yet it's a town which has become a city in the past 50 years since Elvis came into the world. Being only subject to recent expansion, Tupelo is one of the most modern small cities in the South. Its shopping precincts are both expansive and chic, yet for big town shopping, Tupelo folks still travel to Memphis, especially just before Christmas. Just over the state border each year, the Elvis Presley fan club coach convoy is joined by a presidential-style police car and motorcycle outrider escort, which ploughs its way through the town, enabling our convoy to pass through red lights, drive the wrong way down one-way streets, and with sirens and lights announcing our arrival, no Tupelian is left unaware that the Elvis Presley fan club of Great Britain has arrived yet again to blitz their city. As the mayor always says in his greeting, enjoy our city and spend all your money. A police-escorted cavalcade stops at all the sites, with the first centred around the store, where, as legend has it, Elvis's father Vernon bought his son his first guitar. And then within minutes, we are off to view yet another unusual shrine. At first sight, it might look somewhat bizarre that nearly 400 Elvis Presley fans should wish to leave their air-conditioned comfort of their luxury Trailways coaches to enter into 110 degrees sunlight just to take pictures of a field. But such is the loyalty of Elvis Presley fans, because it was on this very field that Elvis Presley created quite a bit of history. The field, of course, is the site of the Mississippi-Alabama State Fair. Before the fairground has been photographed from every angle, it's the turn of the police for their photo call, also to be photographed from every angle. The Tupelo police echo the Tupelo symbol as being a city of Southern hospitality, and during the evening parties which take place during our stay in their town, the police are there yet again, knocking down pints and having difficulty keeping up with the alcoholic consumption of the Brits.
Me, Bernie.
So it's back on the coach for another piece of history. This is the school, so it is told, where Elvis's schoolteacher, Mrs. Grimes, first spotted his ability to sing. And as legend has it, the song was Old Shep. Mrs. Grimes is so old these days that when asked to retell the story, she has to be told the story first of how she discovered the world's most sensational superstar. Our base, always in Tupelo, is the Ramada Inn, run by a guy called Jimmy Pappas, who has played host to the Elvis Presley fan club since our first visit in 1972. In that time, Tupelo has really changed, and so too has the Ramada Inn. Its size has grown at least three times, its facilities are lavish, and the tupels are oh so inviting. But first, we go into the hotel for lunch, and a civic welcome from the chief of police, the mayor, the sheriff, and the alderman. A whole town turns out for the Elvis Presley fan club. Joining us today is Joan Deary, Elvis's record producer, who has flown in from her Los Angeles office especially to greet our passengers.
Do you know who I am? Have you any idea who I am? Yes, it's been quite a while, and it's so good to see you again. It's so dark in this place that I can't see your face. Does he know who I am and what once was between you and me? Do you know how I try? Have you any idea how I try? Not to keep you inside. Do you know, darling, how much I cry? I remember you said that you had to forget about me and be free. Do you know who I am, or have you forgot about me? Do you think there's a chance you and I could start over again? Is there a prayer you still care, or has it just been too long and true? Well, what about you and him? Oh, he's only a friend. Well, I see there's still a chance for me. Or maybe some other time, in some other place, with our love in your heart and a smile on your face, you will know who I am. When that time comes, you know who I am. You will know who I am. When that time comes, you know.
One addition to the hotel since Elvis's passing is this, the Elvis Presley Suite, which costs $150 a night and is always booked up solid. Our filming on this occasion provided a rare insight for some of our passengers of a room few could ever afford to book.
Simple child.
where humble people go to play. I pray the Lord that I'll grow stronger as I live from day to day. I've searched, but I couldn't find no way on earth to gain peace of mind. Now I'm happy in the chapel, where people are of one accord. Yes, we gather in the chapel just to sing and praise the Lord. You'll search, but you'll never find no way on earth to gain peace of mind. Take your troubles to the chapel. Get down on your knees and then your burdens will be lighter, and you'll surely find the way.
And you'll surely find the
to Tupelo, of course, is to see the humble beginnings where Elvis began his life. The tiny shack has been repainted so many times that I doubt if Vernon and Gladys, if they were alive today, would even recognize their first home together. The shack is now part of an Elvis Presley center that includes a youth hall, swimming pool, souvenir shop, and a chapel built after Elvis's death as an international, interdenominational place for meditation. It's when you take your first look inside the humble shack that you realise that Elvis Presley really was born inside a shed. His beginnings bear no resemblance to where Elvis spent his final years in Memphis, in Graceland, where our tour returns to after our Tupelo experience.
So hush, little baby, don't you cry. You know your daddy's bound to die. But all trials, Lord. Soon. Even if you failed your Mocko level in geography, Memphis, for almost everyone in the Western world, conjures up visions of the Mississippi, that old man river that just keeps rolling along. Without the mighty Mississippi, Memphis would not have become the bustling centre of commerce that it is today. The Mississippi brought timber to house the planters, slaves to work on the plantations, and took cotton from the plantations downstream to New Orleans for shipment throughout the world. The Mississippi brought prosperity and poverty, happiness and heartache, peace and war, to an area that without its waters would have become just another dust bowl. The bridge that spans the Mississippi links the states of Tennessee with Arkansas, and the trucks that pass both ways across this expanse of water bring both food and commerce to the communities that flank this river of tears. On the Tennessee side is Mud Island, a new complex that is a mixture between a cultural centre and a theme park. It has only been open for 18 months. When Elvis Presley was alive, Mud Island was literally an island of mud, silt and sand, forgotten by the Mississippi River. When you visit Memphis, don't expect to find any 125-mile-an-hour intercity specials zapping through the Tennessee countryside. The age of the train has certainly passed by Memphis, and the railroad that backs onto Goldsmith's store competes very unfavorably with the Mississippi as a means of moving merchandise.
Train arrived, 16 coaches long. Train arrived, 16 coaches long. Well, that long black train got my baby and gone. Train, train, coming round, round the bend. Train, train, coming round the bend. Well, it took my baby, but it never will again.
St. Joseph's Hospital was a place of employment for Mrs. Gladys Presley, and at one time the only source of income for the Presley family. Whereas St. Joseph's may not be familiar to everyone, every Elvis fan knows this hospital. Elvis was a temporary resident here several times in the 70s, and the emergency room of this, the Memphis Baptist Memorial Hospital, is where Elvis was rushed on that fateful day of August the 16th, 1977. Another building that has more cheerful associations for Elvis fans is Memphis's Lois Movie Palace, where Elvis would work after school as an usher. Although there are Elvis haunts in Nashville, Tupelo, and Memphis, the one of universal, monumental importance for Elvis fans and tourists alike is Graceland. In its first full year of operation, Graceland trustees grossed $3 million in ticket money from the 500,000 visitors who took the $6 guided tour through Elvis's beloved home.
We start our tour at the back of this mansion, so prepare yourself for a culture shock as you enjoy our exclusive view of the inside of Graceland and many of Elvis's treasured possessions. Everyone has heard of Elvis's extrovert tastes in decor, but one room must take the prize for being the most fascinating. We are standing, of course, in the eccentrically furnished jungle room, and it was within these four walls that Elvis Presley recorded his last album.
Well, it's hard to be a gambler betting on the number that changes every time. When you think you're gonna win, you think she's giving in. A stranger's all you'll find. Yeah, it's hard to figure out what she's all about, but she's woman through and through. She's a complicated lady, so call her my baby, a moody blue. Oh, moody blue, tell me am I getting through? I keep hanging on, trying to learn your song, but I never. She's Wednesday into another day again. Her personality unwinds just like a ball of twine on a spool that never ends. Just when I think I know her well, her emotions reveal she's not the person that I thought I knew. But she's a complicated lady, so I call her my baby.
I guess it's fair to say that the world's most famous decorated ceiling can be found in the Sistine Chapel, but that of course is in Rome. Memphis's most famous decorated ceiling belongs to Elvis Presley, and it's constructed from thousands of yards of expensive drapery, located in the Graceland Pool Room. Just as Elvis excelled in entertainment, he excelled in most sporting and leisure activities. Why else was he called the King?
From a jack to a king, from loneliness to a wedding ring, I played an ace and I won a queen. I walked away with your heart. From a jack to a king, with no regrets, I stacked the cards, I stacked the cards last night. And Lady Luck played her hand just right. You made me king of your heart. Oh, for just a little while, I thought that I might lose a game. Oh, but just in time, I saw that tweaker. From loneliness to wedding
and I won the queen. You made me king of your heart. Just a little while, I thought that I might lose a game. Oh, but just in time, I saw the twinkle in your eyes. From a jack to a king. From loneliness to wedding ring. I played an ace and I won.
It's when you finally get inside of Elvis's trophy room that you realize the global success that Elvis achieved during his lifetime and even after his death. Here too is a selection from Elvis's more famous stage clothing and international memorabilia, including the UK's National Benzol Radio Luxembourg Getaway Trophy. All good things must come to an end. The guided tour of Graceland, as does our tour, finishes in the Meditation Gardens. But the last pictures need no comment.
Touch them and they burst apart with sweet memories, sweet memories of holding hands and red bouquets and twilights trimmed in purple haze and laughing eyes and simple ways and quiet nights and gentle days with you. Memories press between the pages of my mind. Memories sweeten through the ages just like wine. Memories, memories.
of holding hands and red bouquets and twilights trimmed in purple haze and laughing eyes and simple ways and quiet nights and gentle days with you. Memories pressed between the pages of my mind. Memories sweetened through the ages just like wine. Memories. Sweet memories.
Right, here we go. First and foremost, we'd like to welcome you on behalf of the official Elvis Presley Fan Club of Great Britain and the Commonwealth. And we'd like to thank you for taking a little bit of time out to come and speak to us.
Oh, I'm really thrilled to be here. I really am. You know, we talked last night, all of us, and I'm really thrilled to be here.
Right, a lot of the people probably don't know when you first started recording with Elvis. Could you tell us just a little bit about
it? Well, there were some sun things earlier, and I didn't do some of the first stuff. Like Heartbreak Hotel was the big one. I mean, that's on Victory.
Yeah.
They used to come in town, Scotty, Bill, and Elvis, and do some stuff. And I didn't live in Memphis.
Mm-hmm.
So they would come in town and do whatever they had to do. But I lived in Shreveport, Louisiana, so I wasn't here all the time.
Mm-hmm.
I never did live in Memphis, so I was kind of commuting back and forth.
And then after the first record, you were...
Well, after that, I've done them all.
Basically, regularly,
I've done Hound Dog, Don't Be Cruel, Jailhouse Rock.
And we know through tapes that have come to light that it's taken sort of 32 takes, etc., to get a song the way I always wanted it. What did that sort of do to you, you know, doing the background music?
Nothing really. You just go in and, you know, you just do a day's work.
Mm-hmm.
And if things wasn't just right, sometimes he would cancel the whole session. He'd say, it's not really happening, fellas. Let's go home and we'll come back tomorrow.
That's
right. And because he wanted it right, and we wanted it right, but if it wasn't somehow what the Americans call gelling, putting it together, well, he would cancel the session and say, we'll come back tomorrow and try again.
Of course, after the first few shows, it sort of took off from there and he went on the road.
Yeah, we stayed on the road for a long, long time.
And what was this, just going about in an ordinary car?
Yeah, it started out basically, Scotty Moore had the only car of the bunch. And we started out in his car, and as Elvis made a few bucks, he would buy a car as we went along, you know. Mm-hmm. And the next thing you know, he'd start buying Cadillacs, so we just start driving around in Cadillac limousines.
And when did the actual sort of tour bus come in, or didn't that come
in? Well, we never had a bus. All the time, Scotty, myself, and Bill worked with Elvis. We never had a bus, or an airplane, or anything else.
But you always traveled together, so Elvis never went on ahead, and you called him up or anything?
Sometimes, if he had other things to do before we got into town, he would either... Well, there for a while, he wouldn't even fly. But then, there for a long time, he started to fly a little bit. So he would fly into the next town to meet us there. So we'd just drive on to the next city and pick him up.
Obviously, before you met Elvis, regular time work on the Louisiana Hayride.
Yeah, that's
did
where...
Did you just sort of drop all that and take Elvis full time, or did you sort of, in between tours, go back to doing other things?
Yeah, when he wasn't doing something, I would go back to the Louisiana Hayride.
Mm-hmm.
But after a while, he got to where I couldn't do it because he was working all the time, day in and day out, 6 or 7 days a week. So we didn't have time to do anything else.
And then what about when they went into TV? Was that something you hadn't done before?
I had never done any TV at all. And we went to New York to do the Dorsey Brothers, which was a playoff of the Jackie Gleason, you know, shows. And we did 6 shows of them. But they'd always, like, book us going in to New York.
Mm-hmm.
And as soon as we get through with the show...
You were out, and then...
We were out. We'd go to Richmond, Virginia, and Northport. They would book us coming back.
That's
it. So we didn't waste any time, you know.
Mm-hmm. And then after, obviously, about making movies. Was it fun or was it a bit of a hassle.
The first movie was a lot of fun that I did.
Loving You.
Loving You.
Yeah.
And after that, it got pretty old.
Because I do remember when we saw G.I. Blues and came on with Sean Oxshorts.
The Alpine uniform.
That's it, yeah.
That's what it is, the Alpines, you know, with the dogs.
I was just wondering, you know, what you felt of doing that type of
thing. Well, I thought the guy was kidding. I went down to the wardrobe and the guy says, "Here, DJ, here's your clothes." And he had his short pants and his little knickers and everything. And I said, "Come on." I said, "They're always pulling jokes on you anyhow." Mm-hmm. I said, "Give me my clothes and let me go. I've got to go back to, you know, the set."
Mm-hmm.
He said, "This is it." I said, "Come on, quit the fooling around." I said, "You know, I ain't got much time here. I've got to go back." He said, "That's it." And he was serious. So I went and put him on. And some next thing you know, I'm sitting on the set. And here comes a little makeup girl. I said, "Now, what do you want?" She said, "Well, I got to make up your knees. Put makeup on." I said, "For what?" I said, "I'm going to be sitting behind the drums and never see my knees." She said, "Got to do it." So she powdered my knees real well. And that was the end of that story.
The other thing I want to say about the early days of touring was, you know, we read a lot about, you know, girls following Elvis here and there. Did any of that sort of happen to you, being in the group? Were you sort of pulled into it?
Well, we'd all kind of run together. Mm-hmm. You know, if Elvis would leave, we'd all have to leave with him, naturally, mm-hmm. you know. So we didn't really have a lot of time. We were doing 7 shows a week.
Mm-hmm.
So we'd all have, right after the show, usually, if we was in Chicago, maybe we was in St. Louis the next day. So we'd have to leave right away. Mm-hmm. Most of the time, we just didn't have any time to do anything.
Mm-hmm. And then when Elvis went into the army, I suppose you went back to not the Louisiana Hayride.
I just went back home.
Back to Nashville?
No, Shreveport, Louisiana. Mm-hmm. I just went back home. My father owned a grocery store there, and I just helped him a little bit. I work on the weekends, and mm-hmm. I went to work for a while with Gene Vincent and the Blue Cats.
Oh yeah, yeah.
You remember Gene Vincent?
Oh, yeah.
And that didn't turn out, so I just after that I just kind of stayed home.
And when Elvis came out of the army and started recording again, we noticed he was using 2 drummers on the session.
Yeah, he thought it would give him a bigger sound. Me and Buddy Harmon done a lot of stuff together.
How did you get on, though, with sort of 2 drummers? You know, did one say, like, "I'm the star," you know?
No.
Drummer or...
No, you don't do those things. You go in and you work it out in your own mind,
mm-hmm.
and Buddy's, we talk about it.
Mm-hmm.
Buddy and I, he'd say, "Okay, DJ, you play rhythm here, and I'll fill at the bridge." Or I'll lay out here and you play here. So we'd all kind of work it out amongst us, you know. There was no hassle because Buddy plays real well. And we played so many times together, we just kind of felt each other what we were going to do. And I'd look at him and he'd look at me and we'd kind of, with our eyes, say, "Well, I'm going to do this and you're going to do that." You know, we didn't have to talk about it. We knew what we was going to do.
Now, as the 60s wore on, Elvis got more and more into movies and less into shows. Did you record with Elvis on through the 60s? Or did
we did all the movie stuff. Good or bad, we did it. Mm-hmm. And
what was your last actual recording session with Elvis? Was that the 68?
I done the 68 special, the original Singer Sewing Machine, mm-hmm. you remember? And that was the greatest thing that ever happened. He looked so good.
Mm-hmm.
I've watched that film. He just looked fantastic. He really did. And he felt good. He was a little nervous. In fact, he was a lot nervous about mm-hmm. the whole show. But I stayed out with him an extra couple of days. He said, "Why don't you stay around?" You know, after we got through, Scotty and I got through, he said, Scotty had to come back to Nashville. He said, "You mind staying around?" I said, "I'll stay around a couple of days, you know."
That's it.
So, yeah, he always wanted someone to be around him that he knew real well and could...
When we saw the show over here, we saw the actual release version, but over the years, bits of old film that wasn't used has turned up, and in there they say, "Does DJ stand for Don Juan?" And somebody says, it might be you, says Dominic Joseph. Is that your real name?
Oh, I think Elvis said that.
Yeah.
Well, one of us did.
So
no,
what
is my real name.
That is your real name.
Not Don Juan. I was teasing
her. Dominic Joseph.
Dominic Joseph.
Yeah,
that's a good Italian name. Yeah, that's true.
So after that and Elvis back to Vegas, what happened then?
Now, we went to Vegas earlier, you know, in 56,
mm-hmm.
and that was a complete bomb.
Yeah, well, that they just released about 3 years ago on box set.
Yeah, I've seen that album.
Because you get a drum solo in Blues Brothers 2, which is, you know, one of the few times they let you do your own thing. I mean, Scotty always gets the guitar breaks, but there's no real big drum break.
No, there wasn't. I'd have to listen to that album again. I hadn't heard it all.
Mm-hmm.
But, and then, of course, we had the big band behind us, which made us really sound good.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. He was not, well, we were ready for that. I don't think they were ready for him yet, you know. He was fairly new at that time, and he wasn't, you know, I don't know, he just hadn't quite come up to the Vegas type act type. And of course we were against Freddie Martin, mm-hmm. the big orchestra, Shecky Green, mm-hmm. and they were doing the show Oklahoma, mm-hmm. which was at that time was a big thing.
Yeah.
And well, you know, they had girls and dancers and you know, and we got up there with three pieces and we were lost, you know. Mm-hmm. But after that, I mean, it's just one of those things that happens, you know.
But why didn't you get into the Vegas in the 60s and 70s? Was that Elvis wanting somebody?
No. He called. Elvis called. And the Colonel called. Mr. Diskin called. And Scotty owned a studio there in Nashville. Mm-hmm. But it was hard for him to get away. And I hadn't been to Nashville very long. And they wanted to go for 10 or 12 weeks, rehearsals and everything. Mm-hmm. And I was really trying to get into the recording situation there. Mm-hmm. Once you leave Nashville for 2 or 3 weeks at a time, well, they forget your name. So I said, maybe I better stay home. And I had two boys then, and I said, I want to kind of stay home with the kids and try to get into the recording end of it instead of traveling. He said, no, I understand, don't worry about it. So that's one reason why we didn't go. That's the only reason. Mm-hmm. Now, they did call. We talked for at least 30 days mm-hmm. back and forth, and it just didn't work out.
So when you didn't do the Vegas thing, you went back to recording and whatever, that was obviously the split with Elvis, and the same thing with Scotty. Did you keep in touch with Scotty?
Oh yeah, I'd see Elvis. We'd go, sometime he'd come to Nashville and he was remixing things, you know, and I'd go by and see him and there was no problem. Because mm-hmm. I did explain to him what had happened. And I wanted him to know instead of getting it third hand or fourth hand or, you know, how that goes. Mm-hmm. So I had to talk to him directly to make sure he understood. It was, you know, I wasn't mad or whatever. You know, I had, you know, those two boys to raise and everything. And now he understood it thoroughly. He said, hey, if I was in your shoes, I'd stay home.
That's it. But you still keep in touch with Scotty Moore?
Oh, I see Scotty. Yeah, I see Scotty. There's not many of us left.
No,
you know, really.
No, I tell you, Bob Neal died quite recently.
Bob died. Bill has, you know, he's been dead for several years.
1963, which is 20 years. Yeah. Does it frighten you when people like this die? Do you feel that you're getting older?
Well, I could be next. Who knows? You know.
But you're enjoying life at the moment, are you?
But I think I'm gonna try to stay around if I can.
Oh,
you know.
I hope. The latest thing we've had in England has been out here a little while. This is this I Was the One LP where you overdub on it.
Everyone overdubbed.
How did that come about? Was that an idea of anybody's?
Yeah, David Briggs and Tony Brown with RCA Victor. Mm-hmm. Tony works for RCA Victor. David is like, they work together on a lot of projects. So they called me in and wanted to know if I would do it. I said, certainly. So what they did, they gave me just a cassette tape. Mm-hmm. So I had to go home and learn all those licks over again. Mm-hmm. After 20, 25 years, you can't remember them, you know.
Because we in England think, you know, you shouldn't tamper with, you know, classical music if you,
well,
if you like.
Well, you know, it's a funny thing. I explained that to those producers. I said, I don't think the foreign markets are going to like this thing, boys. I said, you're tapping with the original conception mm-hmm. of the music. I said, they're not going to like it. And their theory was, we've got to beef it up, enhance it mm-hmm. for stereo sound. So the original track is still in the middle. Mm-hmm. It's still there. We couldn't fool with it mm-hmm. because that was mono.
Now, when you did your overdubbing with Scotty and with George Smith, were you all in the studio together, or did you all do your bit?
No, it was one person at a time, because it got pretty complicated mm-hmm. to try to get the sound over that original. Basically, what they did, by talking to the producers, they zigzagged those tracks back and forth mm-hmm. until they heard what they wanted to hear. But the original track is not, you can't tamper with it. There. The Jordanaires come in, they had other guys come in and do tracks. Mm-hmm. So nobody was there at the same time.
Did you enjoy doing it once you got into it?
Oh yeah. Trying to remember what I did the first
time. It was a bit of a challenge, you know.
It was.
That's it. Now I see you've got a new album out of the beginning years. Is this a similar type thing to the thing that Scotty Moore did a couple of years ago, the first year, Scotty Bill and Elvis the first year?
I tell you what, I don't really understand all I need to know about the album. If you could talk to Mr. Wilson, he knows exactly all about it, and he could discuss that with you.
Mm-hmm. Well, can you tell us a little bit about it, please?
Yes, can we show the cover?
Should we hold
the cover? Would you help me hold it?
Yeah.
This is an album that
a group of people, myself and two partners, purchased from the Louisiana Hayride that DJ's just been talking about. And all of it was recorded at the Louisiana Hayride, except for the narrative, which ties it together and tells some of this early story. And the first couple of songs that Elvis did, even though DJ was there, it was before they had met, and they did not have a drummer. And then after a few minutes into the album, you begin to notice that there's a little more to it musically, and you realize that drums have been added. So this is a collection of recordings that were made over a period of 18 months that Elvis actually appeared on a radio show called Louisiana Hayride.
Is this everything that Elvis did that has been recorded, or is there more to come?
No.
No, there's three songs that do not appear in any other discographies. We do not believe has ever been released. Maybelline,
yeah.
To our knowledge, he never recorded that for RCA or Sun. Twiddly D is also one of them. And we also believe that I Want to Play House With You has never been released again. So in addition to being new tracks or new cuts, there's also new material.
And as I say, you know, is this coming out in England or is it just an American release?
We are releasing it by direct mail in the United States and Canada. RCA will be releasing it in England and the rest of the world. The RCA release will be 60 days after our release, which is this month. So it'll be available in the stores in England in about 60 days.
That's right.
Okay. You get the inside of this?
Yes.
Great inside.
If I could show you the inside, we also have a picture of a young man named DJ Fontana playing the drums. The photograph clearly shows Elvis with the Louisiana Hayride backdrop. And you can also see Bill Black and I think maybe Scotty's hand something is showing.
Yeah.
But front and center is DJ. This is the first authorized release of any material, to our knowledge, that's new since Elvis died.
Back to DJ.
Oh, thank you.
Have you got any plans for the future to come to Europe or anything, to do concerts maybe?
I don't know. I've been invited since I've been down here. A couple of different people were discussing things. I may come over and just kind of talk and do whatever.
So, I mean, people in England would love to see you and Scotty together doing a concert of some
kind. I'd love to get Scotty over it, and I'm going to really work on him. I'm really going to work on Scotty.
Right. And you probably know a lot of books out on Elvis since 1977. Have you got any sort of thoughts on them at all?
Well, to tell you the truth, I've got all the books at my home. People have sent me, but I've never read the first one. I don't see any sense in reading them, because the man always treated me decent. He was always a nice man to me. So why should I read the garbage that people have to write? I don't understand it, and I don't want to understand it.
I see you've got your own book here of photographs. Have you ever thought about doing a book of words? You know, what it was like on the road?
Yeah,
sort of thing?
I'm thinking about it kind of seriously now. I'm trying to get Scotty to do it with me. Maybe some of the Jordanaires, you know, Gordon and the guys. We're trying to, we may piece one together.
And
it will not be negative. It's going to be positive. And I think that's the way we should go now.
Right.
I'm so tired of hearing the negative stuff. It makes me sick after a while.
Well, we all think in England that the main thing about Elvis is he entertained people. That's
his music is the main thing.
That's the main thing. That's what we want to know, you know. Anyway, thanks again for sparing us a half an hour, 20 minutes, or whatever.
Enjoyed it.
It's been great talking to you.
Thank you.
We hope to come back to see you
personally. I know it's hot here and you're in a lot of discomfort. So we'll
oh, you're very kind. Thank you.
Well, thanks very much.
Thank you.
Anyway, thanks again.
Thanks a lot.
Sorry about that.
Oh, thanks a lot.
Nice picture for you
it's
as
my
well.
Pleasure. Thank
Cheers.
You so much.
I'm going to look forward to
Did the colors come out
you.
And everything? Was you okay?
I think so. We're having trouble with the main, I'm going to be running all off battery.
Actually. We're including this book. I thought you knew it. Yeah, we're including that book in the U.S. in the USA release. Right.
And there's some other stuff, too.
And we're including a couple of contracts where Elvis signed and Gladys and Vernon. It's going to be a nice package.
Yeah, that's right. I'm looking forward to getting Have you got any of that or what?
No, it's being pressed now. We just got that. Last week. We just, final approval of the negatives went to RCA, I think, Thursday of last week.
RCA? How long is it?
Well, it's going to be on a Hayride label, but it's manufactured by RCA. We had to license the performances from RCA naturally.
Well, it's good it's coming out on that.
It's legit, you know. Legitimate. Oh, yeah.
I mean, you know, you'll get it coming out on some obscure label that people have never heard of, and it'll be a stupid price. The ordinary band fund for
He wanted to do it legit. Mm-hmm. You know, with no waves and no FBI coming to look for you. That's why he went through Victor to do this thing. It took him 3 years to set it up, you know.
Yeah, so thanks again for coming.
I enjoyed it.
I was watching a film on television back in England quite recently called Nashville. You get Robert Altman, you
know, yeah, I did that.
Yeah, yeah, well, there's this woman dancing around.
Yeah, the stripper.
DJ Fontaine? No, he wouldn't be in a movie.
I certainly did.
Taking away, but only on the drums.
I was watching abroad.
So you've done other little things, you know?
Oh, yeah. I've got one coming out now called Boone. Mm-hmm. It's a kind of a rock and rollish country type thing. Mm-hmm. And I'm just doing like a drum type thing, again, in the background, you know. And they're trying to make a series out of it. See, if it works, I'll maybe, you know, end quite a bit of them.
Look at
it's a new series just coming out. It should be out in the fall.
Was it the TV or from
the TV? The guy that did that, he did. The guy that wrote the thing was Little House on the Prairie.
Oh yeah,
He's written a lot of them. Yeah. You know, so it. The guy's, you know, he's done a lot of big things. So they're looking for good things there. They really are.